Hi, I'm Rhett. Today we're going to talk about A-B testing and statistical confidence. And we're going to answer some important questions like how long should your A-B test run? Or how do I know if I have a true winner with my A-B test? Or how should I use statistical confidence in my A-B testing? If you've had questions like this, then this video is for you and let's just dive into it. In the A-B testing world, there's a lot of people out there pitching that you need to determine your specific sample size by using a sample size calculator, or you need to use a test duration calculator so you know exactly how long you should run your tests. There's a lot of problems with this though. It's building assumptions into predetermining an outcome when the whole point of A-B testing is to let the data tell you the outcome. So I'm going to teach you the four things you need to do so that you know exactly how to call a test winner and so that you don't make the mistake of calling a false positive, or what that means is calling a test that's a winner when actually it isn't. There's a fundamental flaw with using statistics by itself. If you just plug in the conversion numbers into a calculation, it will give you an output every time. And the problem is there's no human read on whether that output is valid. If you have a variation with 11 conversions and you have another variation with one conversion, if you do a purely statistical calculation on that, the version with 11 conversions will have like a 90% confidence. Common sense says that 11 conversions isn't enough and one conversion isn't enough. But that shows how statistics by itself can give you the wrong answer if that's all you rely upon. So there's three other factors you need to consider first before you even look at your statistical confidence. The first thing that you need to be able to call clear winners every time is what I call sufficient data. Now, sufficient data is when you have enough conversions to have a good representative sample for your site. So, and that's different based on your site. If you're a startup and you only get a few conversions, then you need, your representative sample is smaller than if you're a large company that has thousands of conversions every hour. So for example, a staples.com that's going to get thousands of conversions in just a few minutes is going to need a much larger sample size to declare a test winner because they still need a representative sample of their data. If you're a startup company and you only get a few hundred conversions, then you want to make sure that as a minimum baseline, you want to have at least 100 conversions per experience to be able to call a winner. So there's a minimum threshold for everybody. Like, you don't want to be interpreting data with just a few conversions, but you also want that to be a representative sample. So point number one is you need to have sufficient data. That data to be sufficient needs to be a representative sample, and it needs to be representative to your business. And you always want to have at least 100 conversions per variation, but likely that's going to be more based on where you're testing, what's represented for you, and what your conversion metric is. So the first thing you need is sufficient data. The second thing you need is consistent data. This is a simple one too, and this is where the human element of interpretation comes in. When you run your reports and you look at the graph of conversions, the first few days, you're going to have a lot of crossover. That's natural. It's like the dust is settling. And what you want to look for though is consistent data. So for a test to be a winner, it needs to be winning consistently, and I like to see it winning for at least 5 days. So there's a lot of people that say, how long did I run my test for? Well, that just depends. If within 1 week, you can have a consistently winning variation for 5 days, then that might be enough. Often for the testing we're doing, we like to have a 2 week minimum because we want to see two sets of weekends and two sets of weekdays, and we want the test to be winning consistently for at least 5 days. So what you'll see in the graph, if the graph is trending like this and you have the loser down here and it's consistently winning, then you know that you have a consistent data set and you have a winner. Now, on the other hand, if you see the graphs crossing and they're kind of doing this thing, then that's an indication that either you need more data, or number two, it's an indication that the change isn't significant enough. And so no matter how long you run the test, those graphs are going to keep crossing because there isn't enough change to make a difference. This also ties into your statistical confidence calculation too. The more you have a graph that is different than the other one, consistently different in the trend, the more likely you are to have a larger statistical confidence number. So if your trend is very different, it's more likely that you're going to have a 90% or 99% confidence because there's a difference in that behavior. If your graph, on the other hand, is crossing, every time that graph cross on your variations, then your statistical confidence will come down because the calculation isn't as sure because it's so close to each other. So the second thing you need is consistent data. Again, the principle, look for at least 5 days of consistent data, minimum of a week, but you probably, you know, based on your business and what you're doing, you might want to look for 2 weeks of data or whatever is good for your business cycle. Some people like to see two business cycles in there to make sure that you're capturing all the relevant information. So look for consistent data in the results. The third thing you need to make sure you have a clear test winner is what I call differentiated data. And what that means is you're looking for a difference in the data. So to have differentiated data, you have to have a lift that is above the natural variance for that site. But variance basically is the idea that if you do nothing, that there are natural fluctuations in your site. So if you can do a variance test by running a control versus control versus control, and the difference between those variations will be your variance for that page or the site that you're doing it on. So differentiated data means that your lift has to be above that natural variance. And so in general, like if you don't do a variance study, in general, any lift that is between -2 and 2%, that kind of neutral range, that's what I would consider natural variance. And so if you get a 1% lift, it's probably just natural variance. If you get a -1% lift, natural variance. But for most sites, if you get anything above a 2% or below -2% lift, then that's likely that it's not due to natural variance and you now have differentiated data. The other part of differentiated data that's important is if variation 1 has a 3% lift and variation 2 has a 3.5% lift, then that's not very different. You don't really have a winner. You might have a winner above the control if your variance is greater than or less than 2%, but you want to look for something that's very different in its lift. So that's differentiated data. Make sure that your data is above or below natural variance and make sure that your outcome for each variation is very different than each other. And the more different the variation is to each other, the less sample size you need. So if you have a lift of 50% on one variation and the other variation has a native lift of 20%, because that spread, that difference is so big, then your sample size you need is smaller because you're more confident that there's differentiated data. However, if you have a 3% lift and a 3.5% lift, like I said, then you need more data to really determine if that 0.5% difference is really something or if it's nothing. So those are the main three measures you need. If you have sufficient data and you have consistent data and you have differentiated data, there's a really high likelihood that for that test, you're also going to have statistical confidence. And so statistical confidence is like the nice thing to look at. You know, if you have those three things already in line, you probably have statistical confidence. But the problem is that people look at their data and like, do I have confidence? Yay, it's 95% or it's 99%, sweet, but they don't have enough of a sample size, or they don't have a consistently winning variation, or their lift isn't really that different than the control, or it's within natural variance. And so be very careful not to let your statistical confidence number lead you astray into calling winners, when in reality you have to look at these other things that really require the human element of interpretation. But since we're talking about statistical confidence as the fourth factor you need, let's talk about that for just a second. So your statistical confidence should be it depends on your threshold for making mistakes. In my opinion, if you have the first three factors in line, then a lower statistical confidence is okay. If I see the confidence at 90% and I have sufficient data and consistent data and differentiated data, then I'm okay with 90% because I'm pretty sure that that trend's gonna keep happening and I already have a good sample size and I'm okay to call the test. Some people are like, no, you have to have 95 or 99% because you want to make your error rate low. Well, you do if you're not looking at any other factors. Because if I'm looking at a data set and I have the first three factors and it's only at 90%, I'm pretty sure that if I let the test running, it's going to get to 99%. In general, over 95% or 99%, that's a good range to be in. Just make sure you're not using that one number alone to call your test. The other thing that you should know is your confidence interval. So your confidence interval is the range that it could be. So if you have a confidence of 90%, but the range is like 80 to 95%, you can see the confidence interval is a little on the lower side, and that should tighten up with more data, so your confidence interval is a tight number and closer to the actual confidence number itself. But the confidence interval is important to look at because it does show you the range and how much data you may need in addition to what you have to tighten up that interval. The other thing that you might want to look at when you're looking at the statistics is the conversion range. So if the lift that you're looking at is 15%, but the range for that calculation is like -20 to 30%, that's a pretty big range. And so if you have a large range on your intervals, whether it's your conversion interval or your lift interval or your confidence interval, that's a good indication that you probably didn't make sure you had enough of the first three factors. You probably don't have enough data and you need a larger sample size. So the statistics are important. Look at your intervals, look at your confidence number itself. But more important than that, make sure you have the first three factors in place to call a test winner. So to answer the first questions we started with, how long should you run your tests? Well, you should run your tests until you have sufficient data, you have a good representative sample size, And you can see a consistent trend. You have consistent data with at least the winner winning at least 5 days in a row. If whether that's a minimum of 1 week or as long as 2 weeks or a few business cycles, that's up to you. But make sure you have consistent data, and then make sure you have differentiated data. When you have those three things, you'll likely have statistical confidence, and you can say, I have run my test long enough and I can declare a winner. And then the second question is, how do you know when your winner is a true winner? Same way, use this model, these principles, and you will be reducing the likelihood of calling a false positive, and you'll make sure the tests you do call as winners will truly be winners for your site. Thanks for joining me today. I hope this was helpful. Hopefully these principles will help you call better tests. If you liked what you heard today, please like the video, and you can also subscribe to my channel. I do post new videos every Thursday. And finally, you can also visit me at testingtheory.com, where I have more training and courses on this very thing. I have a whole course on calling a winner with some more examples and case studies on that. And then you can also see the other courses and information I have on testingtheory.com too. So thanks for joining me today, and good luck with your testing efforts.